Hi, I'm Dr. Ben Newman. This is Ask Dr. Ben, where I try to answer your questions based on my experience with 25 years now of working with coronaviruses, growing them mostly, doing stuff like that. So this is a response to the sort of intelligence briefing. I have seen an abstract of it now. This is the latest U.S. probe into the origins of SARS-CoV-2. So let's talk about it. So what the report concludes is that basically it's inconclusive. It cannot make a definite conclusion as to where the virus came from, although they do say that the two possibilities that are open are lab leak and natural emergence. The things they are more definite on are that the virus does not look as though it was purposely engineered. And I can tell you, we're growing a lot of strains of the virus, some of the early ones, some of the more recent ones, including one that I isolated all by myself. So good job there. Yeah, a little pat on the back. And I can tell you it's night and day between the more recent strains and the early strains. The early strains are just bad at everything. And the more recent strains cause a lot of what we call cytopathic effect, which is really just overwhelming these little cells with more growth of the virus than they can handle, I think. So it's not necessarily a sign that you would get more virulence, but it would probably correlate with more spread, and kind of does, yeah. So not engineered, and they also concluded that they do not believe that the Chinese government had any foreknowledge of this particular variant or this particular outbreak. And they also conclude that probably the first case appeared sometime around November and then began to spread widely in Wuhan City. And they don't mention the Wuhan seafood market, but I think somewhere around half of the early cases are directly associated with the market. And, you know, that's pretty good evidence that at least somehow it was connected, with the early spread. Could be the actual origin, could be a place where a person went and just happened to get a lot of spread for whatever reason. So I don't know that there's any way to actually definitively show that. The reason, though, to make this one is to actually say, all right, how would let's say a scientist like me, how would a scientist like me look at this data, and what are the strengths and weaknesses of it? I think there's some value there, because what I see here is a lot different than what I'm hearing news organizations maybe see here. So for me, the big problem is that the origin of SARS-CoV-2 is a scientific question. Not that it's something that only scientists could possibly understand or care about. No, no, no. It's just a thing that can and in fact must be addressed with scientific data, which would look like a strain in a vial in a place with some kind of record on where, when, how, and by whom the strain was picked up, because it would have originally come from some kind of animal. And then also a genetic sequence of that strain. And the genetic sequence would then be plotted on a little family tree. Here's our family tree diagram. And it would be right down at the base, and all the other strains that got out into humanity would then trace back to this one. And you would have to do some careful statistical work to make sure that your tree held up and that you had the bottom part, which we call the root, in the right place. But yeah, I think it would be fairly evident based on the small number of mutations and a few mutations which would probably be unique to this strain. So that's the evidence we would be looking for. What the report is looking for is more like what I would imagine an intelligence report is. So think back to the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq thing. Turned out to be incorrect, but it was based on the sort of data that I could see being very useful in an intelligence sort of organization. So with science, you want to be real slow, real careful, very deliberate about documenting every step, and you need to overwhelm with evidence that a thing is the case. Yeah. And if you can't, then it's a scientist's job to not believe you. Yeah. Whereas, consider perhaps an incipient terrorist threat or something like that. you would want a government to act on maybe less. Because you can't just grab the terrorists and bring them in and say, are you planning to do it? Tell the truth. And you can't grab all of their bomb-making equipment and bring it in and test it out and test for residue and do... You can't do all the tests you would want to do, because the idea behind an intelligence sort of investigation is that you need to be quick and decisive. Whereas in science, evidence that would be considered useful potentially for an intelligence investigation, which would be like things that you've heard, which would be hearsay in a court of law, or things that you think you saw, or things that aren't maybe direct evidence but are kind of around it and create a cloud of suspicion. Those would all be useful in intelligence and completely worthless if you're trying to demonstrate beyond scientific reasonable doubt exactly where a thing came from, what happened, how it works, that sort of thing. So the analogy we could make is that, say you're in the intelligence community, you see a person, you see some smoke, and you say, where there's smoke, there's fire, and where there's a person and a fire, maybe there's arson. Yeah. And that would be a reasonable conclusion to then launch some kind of investigation and go do something, put out the fire at the very least. With science, you would want to say, whoa, maybe it looks like that, but could this be a dust cloud? Let's look for chemical signatures of combustion, things that are burning. Could this be a volcano? Well, there are very particular things. There are certain isotopes that you're going to get more commonly in volcanoes, I think hydrogen isotopes in particular, and less commonly in just regular nature. Yeah, and so we can look for those. Is there actually a fire there? Is this not just like a dust cloud? And so a fire would have heat with it. You would have an anomalous heat source there, etc. Yeah, you know, can you show that in this area there's a combustible material? Can you demonstrate that it's combustible by actually taking a sample of it to the lab and burning it? You know, all of these things would take a lot of time and would try to absolutely pin down the idea of, you know, there's something that looks like smoke. Is there fire? Yeah. And so that's kind of the difference. Evidence that's generated with a scientifically sound process would be immensely useful in an intelligence kind of setting, but would be very rarely available on a timescale that would be useful. Yeah. So what we've got here is an intelligence attempt to answer what is a scientific question, and it came up, you know, with an inconclusive result, as I think it only can. So at this point, I would say that I don't think there's anything that is either conclusively possible or impossible. Like, all scenarios theoretically can exist, but as a scientist, you've got to follow the data. And right now, there is no data that would be scientifically valid or conclusive or particularly relevant that actually points to this particular virus and not one of the many, many relatives from nature being in that particular laboratory in Wuhan before the outbreak of COVID-19. And there is considerable data that there are lots of very similar viruses that are in nature, and that coronaviruses emerge from nature into humans and nature into other populations all the time. I mean, this is what happened with MERS. This is what happened with SARS coronavirus 1. There's a very nice sort of, not chain of custody of the virus, but a very clear path of it going from bats to civets, a couple sort of side paths that don't really go anywhere, and then from Himalayan palm civets making a particular mutation, and then with that mutation it's able to jump to humans. So the preponderance of evidence, the weight of evidence, is still very much on the side of this coming from nature, and there really isn't anything that would be scientifically relevant or useful on the side for the lab leak. And so as a scientist, you have to go and say that this is where the evidence is right now. Ultimately, consider this. If the virus came from nature, from an animal straight to a person, with no malfeasance or no virologists involved, which I think is probably the likely scenario, just based on this is the thing that always happens in the world up to this point. Then there would be no scientifically relevant evidence in the places where the investigation was looking, because the only evidence would be in some kind of forest, in some kind of animal, probably in Asia, but you know, it also could be along a trade route that leads to Asia. And frankly, that's a lot of ground to cover and a lot of work to be done. Yeah. And if that was the case, it would not matter how many times you sent teams of investigators back to China, back to this one lab. If the data isn't there and wasn't there, it doesn't really matter how many times you basically flip over the same rock. You are not going to find the data. Yeah, because it does not exist. So that's where it is right now, as far as I can understand the investigation. So, there you go. Yeah. Inconclusive, but boy, yeah. I don't know how many more of these reports we're going to do. And I know that the report also concludes that the Chinese are not being super duper forthcoming, but at the same time, it feels like America is demanding a lot from the Chinese and not offering anything. And it kind of feels like the Chinese suggestions that why don't you go look at Fort Detrick or whatever, that just feels like a very tit for tat kind of thing. Like, what, you can make this allegation, so can we. Yeah, I think we should probably all grow up and play fair, but I don't think there's any scientific relevance in any of that, because the actual answer to this, as we've kind of said all along, is going to come in the form of a nucleic acid sequence of a virus that's very closely related, and then probably at that point a little bit of detective work will come in. So let's say you have a virus similar to this in a pangolin in Malaysia. You can say, are pangolins in Malaysia being smuggled along various routes into China? And if the answer is yes, then you can say, do the pangolins in Malaysia natively carry this, or do they get it from bats in Malaysia? Something like that. Was there a shipment of these animals? Did something like this happen? And so at that point, you can actually, you've got kind of a framework, and you can start to see if you can trace out some of the why and how to go along with the what that you now have. But without the what, you got nothing, basically. So there you go. That's how I see this whole super weird process and the state of the evidence right now. So there you go. Thanks very much. That's all I got to say on this for now. All the best out there. This has been Ask Dr. Ben.